Good morning, children. Today we are going to start the next chapter, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. And in this chapter, we are going to learn about the microsporogenesis in this part. So here, the first thing what we have to learn is the structure of a flower. So here you could see the flower has many parts, and it is the most important part of the plant, because you have already read the sexual reproduction. So you know the flowering plants are able to reproduce sexually. So here a typical angiosperming flower consists of four rolls. What are they? That is calyx, corolla, androecium and gynoecium. So here if you will see these two, the calyx and corolla, though these are essential to protect the flower and also for pollination, but here in the sexual reproduction, the male unit and female unit, they both are essential and these are fertile. So here we have to learn about the pre-fertilization, the structures and events. Here what you have to learn, several hormonal and structural changes result in the development of a flower. Influence bear the flower buds and the flowers. Flowers are the reproductive parts of a plant, and the male reproductive part is known as androecium and the female reproductive part is called gynoecium. The androecium consists of rolls of stamens whose number is variable in flowers of different species. The stamen consists of the filament. Filament means long and slender stalk-like structure. And anther is the bilobe structure. The filament is attached to the thalamus or to the petal. Then here you have to learn the structure of a typical anther. A typical anther is bilobe. Now you could able to see it, the structure bilobed, and it is, the structure is four-sided tetragonal structure. So here you could able to see the tetragonal structure, and between these, this is the line of dehiscence. It forms a roof-like structure. It is called line of dehiscence. Four microsporangia are at the corner. So how does it develop? Actually, if you will see this picture, then you could able to see the anther consists of homogeneous cells, and after that one hypodermal cell in each of the four corners become differentiated to form archisporial cells, and these archisporial cells undergo a periclinal division to form the outer primary parietal layer, which develops into the walls of the anther and the inner sporogenous tissue. Which develops into sporogenous spore microspore mother cell. So here if you will see the structure of microsporangium. So here you could able to see the anther is four-sided structure. You have already seen that. It consists of the four microsporangia located at the corners. Two in each theca. They further form pollen sac. which contain the pollen grains. The microsporangium is surrounded by four wall layers. As you know, this is in this sequence: epidermis, endothecium, middle layer and tapetum. So epidermis is the outermost layer and tapetum is the innermost layer. The outer three layers are protective and help in the dehiscence of anther to release the pollen grains when they are mature. The tapetum provides nourishment to the developing pollen grains. This cell shape, tapetum cell shape, dense cytoplasm and generally multinucleate. In the young anther, the sporogenous tissue forms the center of each microsporangium. If you will see the section of anther, now you could able to see these are divided into different layers. So here, if you will see, the layers are different. It is epidermis, then endothecium, then your middle layer, and here it is the tapetum. So it is rich in the cytoplasm and it helps to develop the microspore mother cells. They are able to take the nutrition from here. And after they mature, they undergo meiosis and forms four microspores which mature to form the pollen grains. So this process is known as microsporogenesis, formation of microspore from pollen mother cell. You may say it is microspore mother cell, or you may say it is pollen mother cell. As the anther develops, each cell of the sporogenous tissue undergoes meiosis to form the microspore tetras. Hence, each cell is a potential pollen or pollen mother cell. So, each cell is having potentiality to form the pollen grains. As the anther mature and dehydrate, so slowly when the anthers mature, it becomes dehydrated, the water becomes dry. The microspores get detached from each other, because when it is hydrated, when there is presence of water, they remain attached with each other. But when dehydrated, they become separated. They get detached from each other and develop into pollen grains and are released with the dehiscence of the anther. So here you could able to see this structure: pollen mother cell which undergoes two division meiosis and it forms four pollen cells which are haploid in nature. Then you have to learn the structure of the pollen. How is the pollen? So pollen grains are generally spherical, measuring 25 to 50 micrometer in diameter and have two layers. The pollen grains are different from species to species. If you will see, then it looks different. So what does it contains? It contains two layers, that is exine and intine. The outer layer is known as exine. It is made up of sporopollenin, which is extremely resistant and can withstand high temperature, strong acids and alkaline conditions, enzymes. And intine is thin and continuous layer made up of cellulose and pectin. Pollen grains, exine has prominent aperture called germ pores, where the sporopollenin is absent. Actually, through these germ pores, only the pollen tube can grow. Otherwise, it will not able to break the pass through the sporopollenin. So, pollen grains are well preserved as fossils because of presence of that exine. As it is not able to be destroyed. It is very much resistant, so it is kept for a long time. The cytoplasm of pollen grain is surrounded by a plasma membrane. When the pollen grain is mature, it contains two cells. One is vegetative cell and another is generative cell. The vegetative cell is bigger and it contains a large irregular nucleus. It contains the food reserves. While the generative cell is small, it floats in the cytoplasm of the vegetative cell. It has spindle-shaped nucleus with dense cytoplasm. In most of the 60%, about 60% of the angiosperms, the pollen grains are shed at 2-cell stage. In the remaining, shed at 3-cell stage. What is 3-cell stage and what is 2-cell stage? That is, in 3-cell stage, the mitotic division of generative cell takes place. So, it forms 2 male gametes. Otherwise, in 2-cell stage, it is only the one vegetative cell and one generative cell. So, the viability of pollen grains after they are shed depends on the temperature and humidity. It differs from 30 minutes to few months. Then importance, what is the pollen grain? Pollen grain has many importance. It is used as a source of proteins and supplements of food. The bee pollen is also used. They can be stored at a temperature of -196 degrees centigrade in liquid nitrogen and can be used in plant breeding programs. But pollens also cause allergies and respiratory disorders like asthma, bronchitis, for example, parthenium. Now you could able to see the internal structure of the pollen grain, that is the pollen grain, how it is, the vacuoles are present, nucleus, and it is divided, divided into two, here the vegetative cell, but when it is 3-cell stage, not the vegetative cell, but the generative cell only divides to form 2 male gametes. Then what is the function of this vegetative cell? This vegetative cell grows as a pollen tube. This is the function of the vegetative cell and it allows the male gametes to pass through and reach the ovule or egg. So now it is the time to test your knowledge. You go through the question. I think you will be able to do this. Thank you and have a nice day.